So in the last class, we have discussed the Gauss-Markov linear model and also the Cochran's theorem statement. So what is Cochran's theorem statement? We are going to consider a random sample of the random variables x1, x2, so on, xn. For those random variables, we assume that this is a random sample from normal population with mean 0 and variance sigma square. And next we consider the sum of the squares of those random variables with the degree as the quadratic form, sum of the quadratic forms, where the each quadratic form will be having the rank rj, and if you take the ratio of qj by rj, that is the quadratic form divided by the ratio of sigma square, that is variance. So if you consider qj by sigma square, that ratio follows a chi-square distribution, or that ratio is called as a chi-square variate with rj degrees of freedom. So that is the Cochran's theorem statement. And Gauss-Markov linear model, for the set of any independent random variables y1, y2, so on, yn, Gauss and Markov developed the linear model, which is described as y equals to a beta plus epsilon. So what is y? Y is the n by 1 variable vector. A is the coefficient matrix, that is n by m coefficient matrix. Beta is the unknown parameters. So beta, so there will be total m parameters. So beta 1, beta 2, so on, beta m. N by 1 vector of unknown parameters is beta. And epsilon, it is the random effective vector, that is also known as error vector, which is also n by 1 matrix. So under certain assumptions, we have 4 assumptions. So under those 4 assumptions, this model is called as the Gauss-Markov linear model. That is, y equals to a beta plus epsilon is called as the Gauss-Markov linear model. So there are basically 2 types of models, that is fixed effect models
can guess it now. If the parameters are
subfix that is called as the fixed effect model, and if the parameters are assigned by some probability. So here we are having some parameters. So if these parameters are assigned by some, probabilities. So each and every parameter is having some probability value. So if this parameter vector or the parameter values are assigned by some probability loss or the probability values, there are probability loss, there will be different probability loss, right? If they are assigned by those probability values, then that model is called as the random effect model. Random effect model. So this is all about the Gauss-Markov linear model under the two different models, that is fixed effect model and the random effect model. So we know that y equals to a beta plus epsilon is the Gauss-Markov linear model under four assumptions. So according to the fourth assumption, expectation of y equals to a beta and dispersion of y equals to sigma square I, which contains both the variance and the covariance terms. Then if the parameters beta 1, beta 2, so on, beta n are fixed or constant, then this Gauss-Markov linear model is called as is represented as the fixed effect model. Suppose if these beta 1, beta 2 are assigned by some probability loss. So whatever the beta 1, beta 2 values we are considering, if those are considered based on some loss of the probability, then that model, Gauss-Markov linear model, is termed to be a random effect model. So this is all about the Gauss-Markov linear model. Now we will study about our homogeneity of more than two wings, we use the concept of ANOVA. So the problem is solved for testing the significance of two wings by the concept of ANOVA. So here ANOVA means analysis of variance. So suppose when we are having two samples, the two samples, three samples I'm considering, x1, x2, so on, xn1, similarly second sample y1, y2, so on, yn1, and suppose third sample x1, x2, so on, xm1, like this. Suppose I have three samples. So these three samples here, the mean is x1, x1 bar, y1 bar, and this is x2 bar. So we are having three means. Now I have to test this. So always whether they are equal or not. That is, x1 bar equals to y1 bar equals to x2 bar. Whether these three means are equal or not, I want to test. So this can be tested by using the concept of ANOVA. So ANOVA, in the name we have analysis of variation or analysis of variance. So you may be getting confusion. Here we are testing the several means, then why we are calling it as analysis of variance. So we are testing the values right here. Mean means, this mean I am getting by using these values. Mean values I am getting by using the values in our data sets. So mean value depends on these data sets, right? So if there is any variation in this data set, so the variation in this data set gives the variation in the means also, right? So that's why the mean we are testing by testing about the variation in our data. So this ANOVA can be performed by using the F test. So F test, we know it is a ratio. F test is used to find the ratio. So while getting the applications of the F test also, we have discussed in the previous 10 classes that this F test is used to test the several means. To test the homogeneity of the several means, we use this F test. So ANOVA means it is analysis of variance where we find the homogeneity or the significance of the more than two means by using the F test. So now coming to the history of the ANOVA. So this ANOVA was developed by Professor R. A. Fisher. So the concept of ANOVA was developed by, or the term of the analysis of variance was introduced by the Professor R. A. Fisher in 1920. So in 1920, he introduced the concept of ANOVA in solving the problem of the analysis of the agronomical data. Analysis of the agronomical data. So what is agronomical data means? Agro means we know it is related to the farm. Agro, agriculture. So the big data related to the farms. So multiple farms, not just farms, but the multiple farms. So there was a problem related to the multiple farms, or the applying the different fertilizers or different treatments on the multiple farms, that is related to big data, which is called as the agronomical data. That is So it is a very powerful statistical tool which separates. Generally, this is a powerful tool to separate the variation. Powerful tool to separate variations. So we will be having two types of variations, right? What are those variations? Assignable variation and the chance variation. To control those two variations, what are those two variations? Generally called as the controlled and uncontrolled variations. So we know in our data there will be a lot of variations. So it may be a controlled variation or the uncontrolled variation. So controlled variation means the assignable causes which are under the human control. So it separates the assignable causes and also the uncontrolled variation. Uncontrolled variations means the chance causes. So it separates both the controlled and uncontrolled variations in our data. So according to Professor R.A. Fisher, the definition of the ANOVA is given as separation of variation. Separation of variation. Assigned to one group. Assigned to one group. To the variation assigned to group. To the variation assigned to group. So this is a definition given by the R.A. Fisher for the term ANOVA. It is a separation of variance assigned to one group. Assigned to one group of cause. So we will be having different causes for the variation, right? The variation of data may be due to the different causes. The separation of variation, or you can write it as variance, separation of variance assigned to one group of cause to the variance assigned to the total groups. So in the total group, there will be different factors or different causes for the variation. So if I consider the agronomical data only, that is related to farms, the yield of the crop may be not dependent on only single factor, right? It will be dependent on the different factors, but the effect will be on the overall crop. So this will be, this ANOVA will be using as the separation of variation assigned to one group of cause. If I consider different causes like fertilizers, rainfall, irrigation, three factors I'm considering. So I will be separating the fertilizers effect, and the next is the irrigation effect, and the type of the land. So all this I will be separating to the variation assigned to the group. So total variation on the group, that is, it will be showing on the yield of the crop. So the variation in the yield of the crop I will be separating from the variation due to different factors. So this is the definition of the ANOVA given by the Professor R.A. Fisher. So this technique is also helpful in comparing the various factors. So I said there are various, we will be separation of the variance assigned to one group. So here I've considered three factors, right? That is rainfall, irrigation, and also type of land. So based on this, we can compare the each factor, right? So which factor is influencing more? Whether the rainfall or the irrigation or the type of land or the fertilizers. So all, if you know about, if you separate observed. Now, the problem is to test whether there is any difference among the effects of the fertilizers. So, is it showing any effect on the fertilizers or not? We have to know. So, that can be known by using the concept of ANOVA. To test whether the yield of the paddy is significant or significantly differing due to the fertilizers. So, here I have 10 kgs, here I have 20 kgs, here I have 12 kgs. So, is it due to the fertilizers effect or there is any other effect also can be known by the concept of the ANOVA. So, this ANOVA technique separates the total variations into mainly two factors, right? So, total variation we are dividing into two factors, that is assignable causes and the chance causes. So these two are known as the causes of variation. So there is a variation in the yield of the crop of different plots. So why we are getting that variation? So variation is inherent in the nature, that will be obviously there. So but why, what are the reasons for that variation? It may be either the assignable or the chance. Assignable causes are under the human control, whereas the chance causes are not under human control. So we have studied in the last paper also the assignable causes and the chance causes. These assignable causes can be detected and eliminated from the process. So similarly like that, if you have any variations in this plot, that can be detected, identified and eliminated. Whereas the chance cause, these chance causes cannot be detected or eliminated. So now we will see some assumptions of ANOVA. What are the main assumptions of ANOVA? So coming to the assumptions of the ANOVA, the technique of ANOVA is based on the F-test, right? I said this is based on the F-test. So the technique of ANOVA is based on the F-test. So for the validity of this F-test, so if you want to apply this F-test, there are certain assumptions to be satisfied. So among those, the first one is the observations are independent. Observations are independent. So whatever the observations or the data we are considering in that, all the observations must be independent of each other. Next is the parent population should be normal. Parent population. So parent population means from which sample is taken. From which sample is taken is normal. So whatever the, from whichever the population we are selecting our sample, that population should be a normal population. And coming to the third one, various treatments are additive in nature. So whatever the treatments we are using, there I said about fertilizers. So all the fertilizers should be additive in nature. So whatever the treatments are there, that are additive in nature. So these are the main assumptions of the ANOVA. And one more assumption is that all the variances must be equal. All the sample variances are equal. So this is the first sample, second sample like that. Sample variance is denoted with S square. So this one square should be equal to S2 square should be equal to all. If we consider K samples, so it should be equal to K SK square. So these are the four assumptions of the ANOVA. So ANOVA means it is analysis of variance used for the separation of the variation of the one group of cause to the total cause of variation. So variation one by number one. We will continue in our next class.